Please join me in standing for the call to worship. Members and friends of the Conyers Seventh-day Adventist Church, heed the call to worship our God and Creator, and He alone. Acknowledge and extol His majesty and power, His glory and His awesome holiness. Come to bow before Him and declare Him of the universe and King of our lives. Come with broken hearts and surrender your wills and lay them before your God. Sense His miraculous workings on the service, and may we all leave this experience today fully committed to a renewed life and to being a vibrant witness of the love and grace of God in a world that needs it so desperately. And all the people say, let us pray. Lord, we come today to worship you, for you alone are the Creator. You alone are our Savior and Redeemer. You alone are the King of the universe. What a privilege and honor to praise you, and with the Holy Spirit guide us, strive to live a life in accordance to your holy word. Let us share this marvelous message. Thank you for loving us, Jesus, and giving us the opportunity for eternal life. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Please remain standing.
Good morning, and welcome to Conyers Seventh-day Adventist Church. We have been blessed by God for another beautiful day and for our time together. So let us thank God for uniting us as one and rejoice in his sovereignty. We are so glad that you have chosen this place of worship to honor the Lord's name with us. We give thanks to God for both our regular members and the visitors to our church today. Each one of you is special to us, and we want you to feel the love of Jesus as we worship together. If you are visiting for the first time, we warmly welcome you into our church as our brothers and our sisters. The Lord brought you here as a stranger, but we will make sure that you leave as family. Let us reflect this day to the Lord our God with a passage from Psalms 100, verses 4 and 5. And it says, "Enter into his gates with thanksgiving and into his courts with praise. Be thankful unto him and praise his name. For the Lord is good and his love endures forever. His faithfulness continues through all generations." Again, we say welcome.
Good morning, happy Sabbath. Good morning, happy Sabbath to everyone. Are you happy this morning?
Yes.
Then say amen.
Amen.
If Jesus Christ is the reason you're happy, say amen again.
Amen.
What a blessing it is to be found in the house of the Lord one more time, amen? We thank God for this privilege of coming together as brothers and sisters to worship. Why? Because he is worthy. Amen. On behalf of our pastor, Curtis Fox, we want to welcome each and every one of you. Those that are worshiping with us online, we welcome you to be a part of this worship experience. Allow me just to share with you just a few quick announcements. We want to remind you that we have a prayer group that gathers gathers at 4 o'clock on Sabbath, but they also gather during the week. And so if you have a prayer request, if you know someone who's requesting prayer, Sister Beverly Gaines is asking for prayer for herself and her daughters. And so if you have a prayer request, please, there's a prayer box back in the back in the foyer. We invite you to put your prayer request in there because we know, we've experienced it, prayer changes things. We know, we've experienced it, that prayer moves the mighty arm of omnipotence. We've seen it happen in our lives, amen? So if you have a prayer request, please feel free to share it with our prayer team, our uniform club, the Pathfinders. The adventurers are in Cahutta for a camporee, but the Pathfinders, you're meeting today at 5 o'clock. So we ask all Pathfinders to gather here today at 5 o'clock. On tomorrow, the seniors ministries will be having a special presentation by Zoom at 11 o'clock. What time did I say? 11 o'clock tomorrow, a special presentation on Alzheimer's and dementia, unfortunate realities of the 21st century. So please tune in tomorrow morning at 11 o'clock. Of course, prayer meeting, a midweek service. We meet by Zoom every Wednesday. We meet for just 1 hour. And so we invite you to come and participate. Our numbers are wonderful in attendance on Wednesday night via Zoom. So we invite you to come and pray with us, to give us your prayer requests, to give us your praise reports. Tell us what God has done for you on Wednesday night, 7:30. On next Sabbath, we're having a special resurrection service. It's that time of the year that we recognize and commemorate that great sacrifice, the great shepherd of the sheep who gave his life for the sins of the world. Say amen, somebody. We'll be commemorating that on next Sabbath. we'll be having some Bible readings and some interpretations and sacred music to help elevate and edify our souls so that we shall never forget what the Lord has done for us. Amen. So invite your friends and neighbors to come and take part in this special service on next Sabbath. We want to remember those who are grieving the loss of loved ones. Unfortunately, it is literally all around us. People who have lost loved ones all over the country, all over the world. And so we're asking to those who have lost recently, as well as those that lost last year, that are still feeling the sting of death. So please remember our loved ones and our family members who are dealing with grief and loss. And then, of course, we have sick that are all around us. We don't ever want to forget them. We want to lift them up in prayer, like Elder Hughes needs our prayers. We want to remember our good elder, Elder Donnie, had an accident on last Sunday and broke his foot. Lord have mercy. He's going to require surgery. So, Brother Donnie, we are praying for you, lifting your name up today. Also, Brother Laura Scott, Sister Hurdy Williams, we'll remember them in prayer. It says here, Sister Fanny Wilcoxon, but I actually see her in the choir. Amen, somebody. Amen. Pray for you anyway, sis, as you're up in the choir. We're praying for Sister Diane Studer. I think she's in the choir as well. Sister Barbara Trumbull, Brother Nangle, and our good brother David Taylor. Sister Darlene English is asking for your prayers, as well as Sister Veris Nelson. We have an anniversary to celebrate. Cliff Roy and Akulu Cunningham celebrated an anniversary on last Sunday. And we have a whole lot of folk who are celebrating birthdays this week. As I call your name, just raise your hand so we can recognize and see who you are. Sister Andrea Abrams celebrated a birthday on March the 14th, I believe it is. On the 17th, this past Sunday, Judith Grant and Brandy Bramwell, if you're here, raise your hand, celebrated a birthday. On Tuesday, March the 19th, Addison Wallace, along with Camilla Harkes, Leticia Wilson, and Nadine Brown. I believe that she's in the foyer welcoming our guests. Celebrated a revolution around the sun this week. On Wednesday, Brother Eric Brooms and Marlene Brissett celebrated their birthdays. On Thursday, March 21st, Glenn Sudler celebrated his birthday. It's my old classmate over there, Brother Glenn. Happy birthday. Celebrated his birthday this week. On yesterday, Christoph Randall celebrated his birthday along with Dora McDermott. Sherry Stein and Brittany Foreman celebrated their birthdays. And on today, we have a host of individuals celebrating their high birthdays. Sister Tanaya Pascal, she's celebrating her high birthday today. Brother Rashad White celebrates his birthday. Trish Furphy, Hertice Williams, Sister Hurdy, celebrating her birthday. Garth Barnett celebrates his birthday today. And Brother Robert Grant celebrates his birthday. We give God praise and thanks for every one of you, because we know it's God and God alone that can cause us to survive a year on this planet. So we give God praise and thanks for you. Lastly, there'll be a social for our crooked individuals this evening in the gymnasium. We ask you today to worship God in the beauty of holiness. Because all our lives, he's been faithful. All our lives, he's been so good. So today, we worship him in the beauty of holiness. Thank you.
Today's scripture reading is Matthew 16, verse 24 through 28. Again, it is Matthew 16, 24, verse 28. And it reads, "Then said Jesus unto his disciples, If any man will come after me, let him deny himself, and take up his cross, and follow me. For whosoever will save his life shall lose it, but whosoever will lose his life for my sake shall find it. For what is a man profited, if he shall gain the whole world and lose his own soul? Or what shall a man give in exchange for his soul? For the Son of Man shall come in the glory of his Father with his angels, and then he shall reward every man according to his works. Verily I say unto you, there be some standing here which shall not taste of death till they see the Son of Man coming in his kingdom." And this is the word of God's word. You may be seated.
Morning, church.
Good morning.
A happy Sabbath to you.
Yes,
so blessed to be in God's house.
Yes.
And especially, I love to come to church.
Yes.
I get up at 7, and I'm there before 8:30. Because I want to be in his presence.
Yes.
And I want him to continue to be in my heart. There must be a drastic change in our life. And I'm just going to read Psalms 138. I will praise thee with my whole heart. Before the gods, I will sing praise unto thee. I will worship towards thy holy temple and praise thy name for thy loving kindness and for thy truth. For thou hast magnified thy word above all. Let us, who can kneel, who can stand, and who cannot, I'm asking who has preference, I'm asking you to raise your hand. Let us kneel and pray and worship God. Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. Oh, how I love your name. I love your name in all, in everything we do and say. Father, create a new heart in us and renew a right spirit. Now is not the time in our life where we can live a life that is not pleasing in your sight. Lord, as we look around, there are so many toils. There's so many destruction. There's so much war. There's so much killing. There's so much stuff happening around us. But yet, you're faithful to us. And you have brought us into this sanctuary that we can worship you. In a safe and heaven place that we can adore you. We ask you as never before to be with the congregation and help each and every one of us that we can able to ask you to forgive us and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. We ask you to watch over the children. The children plays a great part. These are the children, your children, that will able to be the future generation. I'm asking you to be with them, guide them, protect them. Protect their mind from all the evil you could think about, dear Father, which is bombarding them right now. And help their Lord that they can able to live the life that is pleasing in your sight. We pray for the sick, wherever they are. We ask, dear Father, we ask to a blessing on Elder Hughes. We ask there as never before to be with him at this time because he's suffering, dear Father. And we ask him to bring that peace that passeth all understanding. We ask you to watch over Elder Daniels too. Continue to be with him and to guide him and to comfort him. because we know and grant them the strength they need and to bring them back to health. We ask you to watch over even this church that you have given to us. Everything we have, dear Father, you have given to us. We give you the praise. We give you the honor. We give you the glory. And everything we do, dear Father, comes from you. Because worshiping here on the Sabbath, dear Father, is bringing us back to creation, where we can able to acknowledge that you have created this world in your likeness. So we ask you to continue to bless us and to give us the strength we need. Lord, I just lost two of my family, Terry Alicock and also Hermina. We ask the Lord to be with this family at this time. Since the COVID, about 11 of my family died. Lord, we know you're coming. And we know you're coming and you're putting away most of our family and friends. So when you come, you can raise them up on that great day. I'm asking you to, as we able to live, help us to walk in that newness of life. We cannot be a friend to you and we don't know you. We have to make a radical change in our life. And this heart and this temple of ours, we have to treat it right. And we have to do the right thing and put the right thing inside, that when you come, there will be no more sin. This is exactly what you're coming for, dear Father. You cannot present us to your Father with sinful life. When we get to heaven, it has to be sinless that we can able to walking and you can say, thou good and faithful servant. We ask you to watch over the pastor. Thank you so much for bringing him back and his family. We ask the Lord to be with him. Hide him behind the cross. Help the Lord, whatever comes out of his mouth will able to help us, to enlighten us, and to lift us up, and to educate us. Whatever we have done in our life, dear Father, help that his word will able to be a light unto our path, and that it will be able to guide us to eternity. We ask you to bless us, and all we ask is in Jesus' name. Amen.
Good morning and happy Sabbath, church. How are you guys doing today? Happy to hear that. In the context of giving, this is what the Holy Bible says in Malachi 3, 8 to 10, King James Version. Will a man rob God? Yet he have robbed me. But ye say, wherein have we robbed thee? In tithes and offerings. Ye are cursed with a curse, for ye have robbed me, even this whole nation. Bring ye all the tithes into the storehouse, that there may be meat in mine house, and prove me now herewith, saith the Lord of hosts. If I will not open you the windows of heaven, and pour you out a blessing, that there shall not be room enough to receive it. God has blessed us in so many ways. Let us not forget to praise God through our tithes and offerings. Today's loose offering will go towards supporting the Georgia Cumberland Conference for Evangelism. With your help, this ministry will continue to reach those near and far, and no doubt they will continue to hear about the love of God. Help us help this ministry to continue winning souls for God's kingdom. Will the deacon and deaconesses please rise? Let us pray. Dear mighty God in heaven, thank you for all your blessings on us. Thank you for blessing us with this beautiful day that you have created. Thank you for blessing us with life
to enjoy this beautiful day that you have created. Thank you for putting food on our table, clothes on our back, and a roof over our head. You have blessed us abundantly. I pray that we may give back with a willing heart what you have blessed us with. I pray over our tithes and offering that they may multiply, that they may be used in a way to bring more souls to your kingdom. Dear God, we know that you can do a lot with a lot, but we also know that you can do a lot with a little. May every little count, and like the woman and the oil, may our little overflow. Amen.
Thank you. Thank God. Thank God for choir and this marvelous singing, music, worship, great experiences for the people of God. I believe it was Martin Luther who said that to sing once is to pray thrice. And I hope that you were lifted up even as you listen to that special song. Amen. Thank you, our dear choir. We are happy to have in our midst today Brother Gene Chandler of Michigan. Brother Gene, good to see you. God bless you. Brother Gene is an engineer, I believe, of the computer sort. And last year, I think, donated to our school 20 computers. Amen. And that was a real blessing too. Thank you so much. May God continue to bless you and use you. Your association with Joshua Ndege is a marvelous one. My suspicion is you would even go to the motherland with him to do ministry. Amen. And that soon, Brother Ndege. And we wish you well, too, as you go back home to do service for the Lord Jesus Christ. God bless you both. Sister Ifi and Fufu is here, too, and cousin. And we are happy to have you. That's the cousin of Sister Suzanne Ndege. Amen. Today is a day that in the Southern Union is earmarked as a special day for the promotion of our university. Do you know that the Southern Union Conference of Seventh-day Adventists, of which we are a part, has a school of long-standing, Southern Adventist University. Amen. And for over 131 years, this school has been preparing people for service and ministry in the world. And today we want to pause to remember our school, amen, and the blessing it has been to many, many people. I have known many of them whose lives were touched. At one time, I even thought about teaching there so many years ago, and in fact taught a class last semester because they needed that. But I couldn't do anything this quarter. But my point is this, that some of us, some of our young people may well consider some matriculation to the school that provides Christian education and has the potential for blessing young minds as they prepare for service and ministry in the world. We remember them today. Please consider that as an option. As I do for the building of character in even my own. So, I mean my own children, if you will. I'm glad to be back. Yes, I am glad to be back. We are glad to be back. There is no place like home. Amen. It's good to travel and see new sights, to meet new people, and to have experiences that are entrancing and inspiring, but there is no place like home. Amen. I got to see what happened last week, in a week of prayer, and I would say to God be the glory. I saw preachers, young men and young women preaching the word of God. You didn't hear me. I saw young people preaching the word of God from this place. Amen. And I was deeply moved every service. And I just want to say again, it is good to see the engagement of young people. This should not be a punctilia experience. This should be a continuing experience. And we need more and still more of them to be engaged in doing ministry, even ministry done here. Amen? So I want to say, and I say it loudly, that we should have it more and more, not less and less. Amen. So please, those who are hearing me, join in with us, youth leaders and all. Let us do this. We are ready to make it happen. Let the church say amen. Amen. So thank you again for the inspiration, the deeply moving messages that were spoken by the people of God and preachers some of them I'm sure might have been nervous, but when the Spirit of God got a hold of them, all fear took flight and they waxed eloquent for Jesus Christ. Amen. We came back on Wednesday evening and we got home at 5:10 p.m. and we were at prayer meeting at 7:30 and had a wonderful time. Prayer meeting, those of you who have not been, you need to join. You would be surprised to see what you have missed. Every Wednesday, it's a marvelous experience, and we have perhaps more than 100 people at prayer meeting on a regular basis. Please find a way to join. It will be a blessing to you. You get a chance to share, and you get a chance to be inspired again. I want to talk today about the call to living and dying as disciples. The call to living and dying as disciples. That's the message for today. Matthew chapter 16 is our scripture text. Matthew chapter 16, Sister Haley read it for us eloquently. Matthew chapter 16, verse 24 unto 28, the Bible says this: Then said Jesus unto his disciples, If any man will come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross and follow me. For whosoever will save his life shall lose it, and whosoever would lose his life for my sake shall find it. And what is a man profited if he shall gain the whole world and lose his own soul? Or what shall a man give in exchange for his soul? For the Son of Man shall come in the glory of his Father with his angels, and then he shall reward every man according to his works. Verily I say unto you, there be some standing here which shall not taste of death till they see the Son of Man coming in his kingdom. This is the gospel of the Lord. Father in heaven, we pray your presence with us As we open thy word, we ask, O God, again today that you would feed us with the bread of life, and we will give you the praise, the honor, and the glory, the attention and surrender that this word requires. We ask in the name of Jesus Christ, and all the people say, amen. You know, Christian living is serious business. Let me repeat. Christian living is serious business. The Creator of heaven and earth calls each of us to give our total being in service and surrender to Him. And He counts that as reasonable service, given the fact that He made us, He's our Creator, that He sustains us, our sustainer, and that He has and will redeem us, He is our Redeemer, that He would save us from utter destruction and extinction. He calls on us to love Him and His truth more than our own life. I wonder, are we there yet? I wonder, am I there yet? Am I truly willing to give everything that I have for Jesus? Am I willing to stand or to kneel in the face of a long rifle pointed at my head, my brain, and then simply to hear a click and then fall to the ground with blood oozing out of my nose and mouth, to be dismembered, to be beheaded for my Jesus, being fed to hungry lions as they come charging at me for their daytime meal? Question, are we there yet? And think about this. All you need to do to escape that situation, all you need to say is to renounce Christ, or that you renounce the authority of His word, or some Christian doctrine, maybe the Sabbath, for example. I don't really believe that, so let me go free. I know many people who talk about dying for Jesus in the last days. Well, some would have, you know, that privilege for sure. But is not living for Jesus a greater feat? I mean, think about it. Dying may be a one-time experience, a one-off experience. The click of a gun and you are gone into eternity, waiting the call of the life giver. That could happen in a blink of a second. But living for Jesus is a continuing experience of submission and surrender to Him. I would suggest that maybe living for Him is perhaps more difficult than dying for Him. Am I making sense today? Let us go then to our text for today. In that text, we see some things that are important, I would say. Jesus is speaking for most of it, 99.9% of this expose are words of Jesus Christ in my Bible, all in red. In fact, only the introduction is black in this case. Then said Jesus unto His disciples in red, now, if any man will come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross and follow me. For whosoever will save his life would lose it, and whosoever will lose his life for my sake shall find it. And what is a man profited if he shall gain the whole world and lose his own soul? For the Son of Man shall come in the glory of his Father and with his holy angels, and he shall reward every man according to his works. Verily I say unto you, that there be some standing here which shall not taste of death till they see the Son of Man coming in his kingdom. And what are some of the lessons from the text today? I assure you that there are many important things to learn from this text and any other, perhaps. But may our reflection, our contemplation today help us to focus on this important reality, the call to living and dying as disciples. The first point I want to make is this. Number one, Christian discipleship is decidedly personal. I want to repeat and emphasize and underscore this point, that Christian discipleship is decidedly a personal experience. The Bible says in Matthew chapter 16 and verse 24, if any man will come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross and follow me. If any man, double underline if you will, if any man, I think it personalizes the experience and the call. Yes, I see set up here some parameters for Christian living. This would never happen just because we are around the right people. Becoming a Christian or a Christian disciple would not come to us just by having an idea about who Jesus is. The man or the woman who wants to be a disciple of Jesus will feel the full weight of a personal experience with God. Are you hearing me, church? If any man, I like the original Bible language in which the Bible was written, the New Testament, perhaps more specifically, because I maybe studied that language just a little more than the other, but I love these words, if any man. And when I read the word if, I realize that it is not the typical word for if. It's a sort of factual condition. In other words, it is saying it is a fact that a follower of mine, Jesus is saying, a disciple will deny himself and take up his cross daily. Let me do it again. Jesus was saying that it is a fact that any disciple of mine will deny himself and take up his cross and follow me. Those who do not deny self and take up their cross to follow Jesus is really not a disciple of Jesus. Are you listening to me? So discipleship does not come by being around the church any more than being around the garage makes one an automobile. Discipleship doesn't happen by osmosis. It does not happen that way. The disciple is one who makes sacrifices of his life for the master. And Jesus is saying, it is a fact
that anyone who says he or she is a disciple gets into the self-denying mode and makes self less important and Jesus most important. Whose preoccupation changes from the things that are typical in the life of this person and registers a new preoccupation where Jesus and kingdom business are most important, more than anything else. If any man will be my disciple, it is a fact that this man or this woman will deny himself or herself and take up his or her cross and follow after Jesus Christ. Now, this is important as I think about it. I reflected on the text again and again this week that Christian discipleship is decidedly personal. And Jesus wants disciples. But let me remind you, he wants you. And just as he needed James and John and Matthew, just as he needed Peter and Paul, Jesus needs you to be his follower. And he is coming down your street. He is getting into your yard, walking, seeing the address on your house, and he wants to come in and establish a relationship with him that is decidedly personal. Jesus wants you. Young people, I know, and I've said before, that sometimes we think that life has to be put off in favor of our own wishes and desires in the folly of youthfulness. But let me tell you, Jesus has used young disciples before and continues to want them all for himself. Come on and say amen, somebody. Jesus wants that. He wants you. It must be a personal experience. I'm a preacher, and I love preaching to people, and it doesn't matter how much, multitudes, even I love it, it seems even more. But this I know, what is more important, that Jesus is concerned with individuals. And every one of us is important to him. And if you come to church today, my young friends, and forget that Jesus wants you, you would be of all men or women most miserable. Jesus wants you, all of you. Jesus wants you in totality. He wants the strength of your youth. He wants your mastery. Jesus wants you badly. And if in fact he doesn't have you, he walks away sorrowfully because he is yearning after you with a godly yearning. He wants you. He wants to engage you in kingdom business that makes a difference for your life today. Listen to me. I said before, Rabindranath Tagore, who said, "I slept and I dreamt that life was happiness. I awoke and I saw that life was service. I served and I found that in service, happiness is found." And let me tell you something. We talk about, I want to find myself. I'm trying to find myself. Well, let me tell you, you will never find yourself until you find Jesus. That's when new vistas open up for you. That's when you feel like you're engaged in something bigger and greater. That's when you are filled with all the fullness of God. That's when the Spirit of God takes a hold of your life. That's when life has more significance. That's when you get up feeling like it's okay. That's when you want to jump out of bed. That's when you can shake off depression and anguish and anxiety and grief. That's when, because Jesus makes all the difference for us. And he wants to do that for us. He wants to save us from a life of uselessness.
and make our lives more full and significant. Amen. Let me say secondly, I must move on. The Christian discipleship embraces the paradox of living and dying for Christ. I saw that too, especially when I read verse 25 of chapter 16. For whosoever will save his life shall lose it, and whosoever would lose his life will find it. Now you see the paradox, the juxtaposition of words, the temptation to a life of fallacy, that thinking that you have life when you pursue life, that you die when you die. Well, let me fix it. In other words, Jesus is saying, if you want to have real life, didn't Martin Luther King Jr. say something like that? But nobody is prepared to die until he's found the cause for which he is prepared to live? Isn't it true that life really is different for us when we are ready to give it all up for Jesus? Isn't it not true? If you are too busy seeking to protect and preserve your own life, you would lose out on the best life. And truly, you would also miss out on the longest life. You didn't hear me. If you are more obsessed about Jesus, faithfulness to him, and sacrificing yourself for him, you would rather have Jesus and the true life that he alone can offer, then you have real life. In other words, if you think that making a living is more important than having life, you will miss out on life. If you don't get it straight, there are some things that get missed, and those things are significant. The Bible says, whosoever will save his life will lose his life. In other words, don't try saving your own life. Don't try dodging the bullet just to live a long life. Because even if your life is snuffed out in honor of your Savior, well be it unto you, for you shall enter at last into eternal life. Because Jesus is the source of life. Not just on earth, but in the earth, the world to come. Amen. He alone can offer the best life. So it's okay to lose your life, for in losing it, you find it. Jesus said that in different ways. If a corn of wheat, except, he says, a corn of wheat falls into the ground and dies, it abideth alone. But if it dies, it bringeth forth much fruit. In other words, listen, if you go down into the ground for the sake of Jesus Christ, with your faith anchored in him, just as Jesus went down, it's saying, even boasting, the Son of Man will be betrayed, that I will lay down my life, and the third day I would raise it up again. Then Jesus went into the portal of the grave, went into the valley of the shadow of death, placed the light into the tomb, walk out victorious. In the same way, all those who believe on him, who go down there, will meet, essentially, you know what I mean, a delight there. That death would have no hold on you. The scorpion of sin cannot bite you in a way that would keep you there. You would rise again through Jesus Christ. Well, let me say thirdly, Christian discipleship is prioritizing kingdom living and kingdom business over the earthly. It's like unto the former, but I think there are some differences there. In verse 26, the Bible says, "For what shall a man, for what is a man profited if he shall gain the whole world and lose his own soul? What good is it? What shall a man give in exchange for his soul?" Well, some people give things in exchange for their soul. Jesus, I'm sure, was implying. But he is saying, well, but think soberly. It doesn't make sense. Nothing matter more to a true disciple of Jesus than matters of the eternal rather than the temporal. Shirking from martyrdom is foolhardy in the grand scheme of things. For seeking physical and material gain at the expense of higher living leads only to a wasted life. The most important thing in life is living. Living comes from seeking the God of life and giving oneself and one's preoccupation to Him. What shall a man profit if he shall gain the whole world? In other words, amass all the wealth in the world, have an awesome portfolio, some stocks and bonds that yield thousands and thousands every day, large buildings here and there, and everything else. And if you have that, but you don't have the promise of life beyond it, then how short-sighted, how myopic is that experience? But if you have little, but you have the promise of life eternal, and all the wealth of the world in the hands of the Savior and Creator of the world, then you have everything. What shall it profit us if we gain the whole world? And I know when we go to school and we get to the bursar's office and they are mean to us there, extracting from us, it seems, blood and all. They're not kind to us when we show up there. If we don't have the resources, we can't register. We got to stand back. And something about that gives us a desire to get more, to acquire a whole lot, to get out of this situation and to be all good in terms of the wealth of the world. And so we come to the world with vengeance, and we just want to amass more and more and more. And sometimes in our amassing of more and more, we see Jesus less and less. Am I talking the truth? And we become preoccupied, seeking after things that are short-lived, the temporal. But Jesus wants to remind us, look, it doesn't profit us if we gain the whole world and lose our soul. You remember the story in the Bible, the man, you know, who had some bonds and his goods were overflowing, and the question was asked, what shall I do with all these goods? He said, I will build greater barns. I will break down the old ones and I'll build greater barns. And I would say to my soul, soul, thou hast done well. Thou hast done well. He started talking to himself. And Jesus says, look, what shall you say when your soul is required of you? In other words, you would have not one word to say. In the end, remember, Gladstone of England was well known in England And people wanted to talk with him. A young man came to Gladstone of England and says, "Young Gladstone, I would love to talk with you. I would love to tell you about my life, my plans, my dreams." And Gladstone of England said, "Sure." And the young man began to share his life. "And I want to go to law school. And I want to become a fine lawyer." And Gladstone of England said, "Very well, young man, very well. And what then?" And he says, "After that, I hope to be admitted to the bar of England so that I can practice law." And he said, "Very well, very well. And what then?" He said, "And after that, I hope to be admitted to the Commonwealth so that I can make a greater contribution to the whole Commonwealth." "Very good, young man, very good. And after that, what then?" He said, "I guess after that I'll retire. I'll get old and I would retire." And he says, "Very well, young man. And after that, what then?" He says, "And after that, I guess I'll die." And Gladstone of England said, "Very well, young man, very well. And after that, what then?" And that young man bowed his head in a somewhat embarrassed silence. He had not one word to say beyond that time. And Gladstone of England looked him in the eye and says, "Young man, you're a fool. Go home and think life through." In other words, don't be so short-sighted. What shall a man give in exchange for his soul? Nothing makes sense in answer to that question but to give one's life to Jesus. Amen. Let me throw in a fourth for good measure. You know by now this preacher is maybe getting old when he suggests 4 points rather than three. Number four, I would say, Christian discipleship finds motivation in the world to come. In verse 27 and 28, see Jesus Christ musing upon this very important fact. Just, "For the Son of Man shall come in the glory of his Father with his angels, and then he shall reward every man according to his works." Really, the works of Jesus Christ. But you know what I mean. Those who hook up with Jesus somehow produce good works. Not that the works save them. We know that. Only the merits of Jesus Christ. But the life yielded to Christ has some kind of future bearing. It creates a plus ultra, a more beyond the present. It takes us beyond even the grave to a coming better day when there will be no more sickness and death and misery in the world, but life everlasting, when from one new moon to another and from one Sabbath to another, all flesh will come and worship before me, says the scripture. There is a coming better day, and that coming better day should motivate us, drive us, should inspire us, enthuse us, so that we might go on anyhow. This world is not our home. We are strangers and pilgrims in the earth. We are looking forward to a coming better day. I say hallelujah. You know, the last 2 weeks found Paula and me in a land that was ground zero for the Protestant Reformation. We saw people and places, churches and institutions, the work of God and the work of the enemy striving for and against truth, God's truth, even as revealed in the Holy Word. The established and universal church had become more and more paralyzed and drunken by traditions and misinterpretation and greed and pride, that she began to look like a most worldly enterprise governed by mortal men who felt themselves higher than that, even as God himself.
They created Jesus in the palm of their hands, offered forgiveness for sins in churches, and spent means so gotten to astonish and mesmerize worshipers with huge and magnificent buildings that would create the illusion of goodness and truth and divine blessing. God's light was turned into darkness, and the allegiance of many were turned away from God and his truth in favor of the grand and the glittering edifices that taught everything else but God's truth. But in the midst of darkness and error, spiritual and moral declension, God had men and women everywhere who stood up and stood out for him. They searched out truth and spoke it from the heart. They declared truth when others did not want to hear it. They spoke up when it was not politically correct to do so. They preached the gospel of grace when they were commanded not to. They spoke God's truth even when their physical lives were threatened. They spoke God's truth even as they were tortured and bleeding, burnt and beheaded, hated and hung, censured and crucified for their stand for the truth, for preaching of the gospel of grace and giving the open invitation to come boldly and directly to God to receive forgiveness for sin and a hope of salvation, and not to the church or to a man who believed that he could offer it at will or at the price of his own choosing. God used many to challenge such ideas and doctrines that became a stumbling block to the masses of people around the world. God had his hand on an Augustinian monk, a little priest, who was also professor of biblical interpretation, a theologian of significance. He was becoming. He could hold his tongue no more, and certainly not his pen, began to speak and write and speak about things that challenged the establishment against the advice of his closest associate. Martin Luther spoke up all the more. You could try to hold the tongue of a man, but if in his heart there is a burning flame, you can't do that for long. Are you listening to me? Against the advice of his closest associates, he spoke up. He was given the opportunity to recant his beliefs and the challenge that he had given to the established church. And instead of defending himself, and instead of securing his physical safety, he took to the witness stand and spoke about God's truth. Hallelujah. He declared sola scriptura, the scripture alone, the basis, the rule for faith and practice. He declared sola gratia, grace alone, by grace are ye saved through faith, and that not of yourselves, it is a gift of God, lest any man should boast. Sola Christus, Christ alone, the mediator between God and man, the man Christ Jesus. Sola fide, faith alone. Soli Deo Gloria, glory to God alone. And I tell you, his preaching created a rumble throughout Christendom that established the church at the time. In 1517, you know the story, Martin Luther penned 95 theses denouncing the teachings and practices of the established church of which he was a part, and nailed those 95 theses on the front door of the church in Wittenberg, Germany. Needless to say, the action brought him to the attention of the church. In 1521, Martin Luther was excommunicated by the Pope and was called to appear before the Emperor. at the diet of worms. Let me be clear. The diet meaning the council, worms being a place in Germany. So a council was held, an important place. I saw it there. He was asked to recant his position against the church or face excommunication or death. His possibly last opportunity to save his skin. He said, since your most serene majesty and your high mightiness require from me a clear, simple, and precise answer, I will give you one, and this is it. I cannot submit my faith either to the Pope or to the councils, because it is clear as the day that they have frequently erred and contradicted each other. Unless, therefore, I am convinced by the testimony of Scripture or by the clearest reasoning, unless I am persuaded by means of the passages that I have quoted, and unless they thus render my conscience bound by the word of God, I cannot and I will not retract. For it is unsafe for a Christian to speak against his conscience. Here I stand, I can do no other. May God help me. Amen. I should tell you, seems as if he was asking for it. Standing in a place with the authority looking squarely in his eyes, knowing the full wrath he had seen it before, knowing what would likely come his way, he stood not in defense of himself, but in defense of his God. Not in defense of himself, but in defense of God's truth. In his word, true disciples live and die, if needs be, for their Lord. They live and die for God's truth. They live and die for God's honor. I have no doubt that the day is coming, sure enough, when the faithful will be called before councils to defend their or to recant their faith at the pain of persecution or death, or maybe both. My brother, my sister, do you love your Lord and his truth more strongly than anything else? Do you love this word so strong that you would stand for it no matter what the consequence? To stand fast for it rather than just seek the comforts of your earthly life. Are you ready to live and die for your Lord? Are you ready to defy systems, secular or religious, men, as you retain your stand for Christ and his truth? Last week we saw what dissent can do. Go look at the statues that were created of Martin Luther, with the authorities putting their foot in his face and worms coming out of his mouth. And they were persecuting him. He is by for sure persona non grata as far as the church is concerned. He brought all the troubles in the world against the church. He defied the authority and he declared what he thought was God. How dare you preach God's word? This is the church, they might have said. We saw the horror of persecution and marginalization and excommunication, torture and death. I wish to ask you about your faith in Christ and your relationship that you now have or that you are building. Are you ready for the challenge soon to come upon us? Those are the questions I came to ask you in this service. And I wish to God that each of us would be as bold as he was to stand and say in the matters concerning Christ and his truth, I will stand and I will do no other. It does not matter what happens, come life or death, angels, principalities or powers, things present or things to come, nothing will take away my stand for Jesus Christ. But such a commitment, it comes by gradual building up of our faith and trust in God, a commitment and desire for his word, spending time panting after the water brooks where the flowing streams come certainly from his fountain that shall never run dry, until that thirst is so great that it finds us coming to him each day, seeking a commitment to his will, until we surrender, saying every day, Lord, take my will, for I cannot give it. How shall we stand in that great day? My brothers and sisters, the call comes to us. Are you willing to live and die as disciples of Jesus Christ? Or live in this world and live boldly like Martin Luther, who penned this song, a mighty fortress is our God, a bulwark, never failing. Or helper he amid the flood of mortal ills prevailing. For still our ancient foe doth seek to work us woe. His craft and power great and armed with cruel hate. On earth is not his equal. Did we in our own strength confide, our strivings would be losing. Were not the right man on our side, the man of God's own choosing. Dost ask who that may be? Christ Jesus. It is he, Lord Sabaoth, his name, from age to age the same, and he must win the battle. And though this world with devils filled should threaten to undo us, we should not fear, for God has willed his truth to triumph through us. The prince of darkness grim, we tremble not for him. His rage we can endure, for lo, his doom is sure. One little word shall fell him. You know what that word is, don't you? I hope you do. That word above all earthly power, no thanks to them abideth. The spirit and the gifts are ours through him who with us sideth. Let goods and kindred go. This mortal life also, the body they may kill, God's truth abideth still. His kingdom is forever. Thank you, Jesus. Our heads are bowed and our eyes are closed. Father, save us from association with all things spiritual. And move us into a dead center experience with our Lord Jesus Christ. Grant us the firmest commitment and surrender to our Lord. May we have a thick, vibrant relationship with him. One that is greater than the ills and the devils around us. One that is greater than institutions that are bent on destruction and denial of faith in Jesus Christ. Save us, O God, in our young life. Save us, O God, each of us, children, men and women, Save us all, O God, to a life of full commitment, so that whatever comes our way, whether it is the opportunity just to live for Jesus, we will do that well. And if we must die for him, may we do it in style, with our eyes fixed on Jesus and the future to come, with life everlasting. Thank you, Jesus. With our heads bowed, and our eyes closed, I never like to end the service without giving you the commitment, the desire, the opportunity to commit your life to Jesus Christ. If you've heard God's word today and you want to say, Father, living for you is serious business, and I am registering my commitment again. I'm on your side, Jesus, and I shall stand for you through your power and grace. If that is your desire, my friend, I ask you to stand with me today. Stood in the presence of the Lord. I wonder, with the next baptism coming, who will be in the pool? I know there are some of you who are planning. If you're here today and you just want to say, Lord Jesus, keep preparing me for this experience sometime in the near future. I want you just to raise your hand. Put it back down and say, pray for me, that God would keep me riveted on that experience to come. Father in heaven, in the name of Jesus Christ, we pray blessing upon us. Save us, O God, now and for eternity. O God, make us stronger. Make us more committed. Make us more dedicated. Make us ready and willing to live and die for you. We pray in the name of Jesus Christ. And all the people say,
entire military.
hope that you're blessed in service today. May we go away from this place and return at the next convenient time, but be sure in the interim to live for Lord Jesus Christ. Let's remember to pray for one another. Certainly to pray for Elder Hughes and Donnie and all the rest whose names I would fail at least in recalling in this moment. But may God continue to keep us. Those who are traveling, go in peace. And may God use you for His glory. Those who return to us, and we think too of our young people who are camping. There are at least 30 of us, I think, who are at Cojada Springs camping this weekend. Adventurers, God bless them. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make His face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift up the light of His countenance upon you and give you peace, now and forevermore. And all the people say, Amen. Please be seated for a moment of meditation.